All right. Well, welcome back to the introduction track. We are pleased to welcome Andre from Multiverse X.
Hello, everyone. Just a second. Okay. Hello, everyone. I am Andre from Multiverse X, which was formerly known as Elrond Network. And today we are going to have a quick lesson on interacting with the Multiverse X blockchain. Let's get started. We will learn to talk to the network through a so-called network provider, and we will create, sign, and broadcast transactions, query account state and storage, and also approach a few concepts of chronology and sharding. And we'll do all this by following two simple tutorials. The first one, we'll create a simple minimalistic passwords manager with encrypted passwords and usernames stored on the blockchain. And secondly, we'll query account state from a so-called deep history observing squad. But before diving into the tutorials, let us meet EarthPy and EarthPy X. EarthPy is the main tool and library that Python programmers use to develop on Multiverse X. However, currently we are experimenting with a new set of libraries, which we nicknamed EarthPy X. And at some point into the future, these libraries might replace large chunks of EarthPy functionality. And today we are going to use EarthPy X for the tutorials. Now let's move to the first one. The first tutorial, a simple passwords manager. Our usernames and passwords will be encrypted using Pinnacle and safely stored on the network on the account storage. And to add something on the account storage, we will be invoking a built-in function. We'll see what a built-in function is, called save key value. And then we can retrieve the secret entries, the usernames and the passwords as needed, and decrypt them as needed. Okay, our password manager will present itself as a simple CLI, and it would be able to initialize a Multiverse X wallet and a secret key that will be used to encrypt the secret entries, the usernames and the passwords. And of course, it will be able to create, retrieve, update, and delete those secret entries. And the CLI will be extremely simple. We'll define one argument subparser for each flow. That is, we'll have a parser for the init flow, one for the insert and update flow, and another parser for the retrieve entries flow. Now, a little bit of theory. Multiverse X offers the possibility of storing arbitrary data into an account storage by calling save key value, which is a built-in function. What is the built-in function? It's a function that doesn't belong to a smart contract, and you can think of it as a function that lives in the global namespace of the network, like a global function. And this is how a transaction that holds an invocation of save key value would look like. And we're going to code such a transaction in our passwords manager shortly. And here's an example of a JSON dump from the account storage as retrieved from the API, key and values. Now, about encrypting the secret entries, the usernames and the passwords, in our application, we'll use the secret that's separate from the Multiverse X wallet. Just that's for simplicity, because we don't want to dive deep into cryptography right now in this tutorial. And we are going to use Pinnacle's secret box facility to encrypt and decrypt the data. Now let's see the init flow of the application. Here we create a Multiverse X wallet. And for simplicity, again, we're going to use a wallet in the plain PEM format, which isn't actually recommended in real world applications. And here we generate the secret used to encrypt and decrypt the usernames and the passwords. Now let's see the update and insert flow, the upsert flow. Here we ask the user to input the usernames and passwords, and here we have them converted to key value pairs, encrypted to encrypted key value pairs. And here we create and also sign a transaction that invokes the aforementioned save key value built-in function. And we'll shortly see how this function is defined in a few moments. But before that, let's have a look at the secret entry class. How is it defined in our application? Well, here is the encryption part. And here would be the conversion of the instance to an account key value pair.
Andre, we have a question coming in. How expensive is storing data with save key value? Is it VM expensive or more like storage chain expensive? Et cetera, Filecoin, Arweave?
This kind of function, when is it invoked, it doesn't trigger an execution in the actual VM because the function is actually implemented natively into the node, into the protocol. It doesn't execute a smart contract, actually. It's some kind of a global function of the protocol. So even if it doesn't execute in a VM, it still incurs a small cost, a small gas cost. And I think two slides after, we will see how much gas is it required to call save key value. And of course, a very little amount of gas will be needed to save one entry. And if you save more entries, the cost will grow a little bit, but still be sufficiently small. If it answered the questions, I would say the costs are very, very low.
Awesome, thank you.
Okay, a great question, by the way. And I think we will see, a gas limit value just in a few moments. And here we implement the extraction part. So here we extract the secret entries from a set of key value pairs that are fetched from the account storage. And here would be the decryption part. And this would be the code that creates a transaction that invokes save key value, the save key value built-in function. And here we are preparing the transaction, like acquiring the chain ID, acquiring the account nonce. And here we compute the gas limit. We won't see the code that computes the gas limit here, but we'll see the output value as an example. And here we sign the transaction. That's the value of the gas limit. And it would be multiplied with a gas fee, and that would result into the actual cost that will be taken by the network. So this is how a prepared transaction looks like, and it's ready to be broadcasted. And if we were to run the upsert flow of our application, we will see something like this. It's a simple application, so you wouldn't expect another kind of user interface here. And moving on, let's go to retrieving the secret entries, the retrieving flow. Here we fetch all the pairs from the account storage, and here we search for the entries that we've created before and decrypt them. And if we were to run this flow, the retrieve flow, we would get a previously saved username and password. And that was the first tutorial. And now we've reached the second one, where we will consume data from a so-called deep history observing squad. And a deep history observing squad is basically a set of observers, of network observers, of nodes that retain not pruned history of the blockchain and allows one to query the state of an account at an arbitrary block in the past. That is, it can answer questions such as the ones depicted here. And now in this tutorial, we will sketch a simple HTTP API using Bottle, an API which allows one to inspect the state of an account at a given timestamp. And we'll have to implement the mapping from a timestamp to a block index. Our application will consist of Bottle controllers and an underlying custom network provider, which would be able to fetch balances for both native and custom currencies, and also to fetch whole account storage data, like the one we've used in the first tutorial, actually. Yeah, and all queries will be performed by timestamp. That's what we want. And those Bottle controllers would be able to resolve these kinds of HTTP GET requests, like getting balances, getting account data. And here is a small sketch of how would that endpoints look in the code. And now we are going to see how could we extend the default network provider to implement what we want. Let's have the example of getting the native balance of an account, which is the EGLD balance, at a given timestamp. Timestamp which in the end needs to be converted actually to a block nonce. So the most important thing here is to implement get block by time. And how would we implement get block by time? And why would we also need to take into consideration the address of interest while doing so? Well, let's talk a bit about rounds and blocks, and then a bit about sharding. The Multiverse X mainnet was born back in July 2020, and back then it was Elrond Network. And since then, at each 6 seconds, at each round, the blockchain produces blocks. And generally speaking, it produces one block per round, per shard. And since given the genesis time, and given the duration of a round, it's easy to compute a round index for any given timestamp. So back to our function, get block by time, we can easily get the round by time. But then the network has currently 3 shards, and plus a special shard called the meta chain. Anyway, all accounts belong to one of these shards, with respect to a partitioning rule that's, again, outside the scope of today's lessons. And every shard builds what can be seen as an individual blockchain, in a way. And every shard produces one block per round, one at each 6 seconds. Though, if we were to go now and sample network data, we would see that block numbers do not match round numbers, and they do differ. And this is because in some rare cases, there are rounds when shard blocks aren't produced, and this is what we call an imperfect hit rate. Now let's go back to our get block by time, and we really do need a way to get the block index by round index. And how do we do that? We'll do so by calling a special API endpoint, which is able to map a round index to a set of shard blocks that were produced in that round. Therefore, here's our working implementation of get block by time. And this implementation also handles some worst case scenarios with rounds that don't produce any blocks. And let's go back to our custom network provider. And in addition to getting native balances, let's instruct it to also fetch custom balances, which we call ESDT balances. And also let's instruct it to fetch whole account data in a similar fashion, like getting native balances. And now we should be ready to query account data and balances at any given timestamp in the past. And here on the screen, you can see a minimalistic dashboard that's included with the source code of these tutorials on GitHub. And on this dashboard, you can interact with the newly created Bottle API. Yeah, that's it. We've reached the end of the tutorials. And what have we learned? Well, to create and interact with a network provider and to create sign and broadcast transactions and to query account state at a given time, at a given block in the past. And we've also learned bits of network chronology and sharding. That will be it. Thank you. And yeah, we'll take in questions.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Andre. I think everyone learned a lot and probably needs to sizzle on that for a minute. But if you have any questions, you can feel free to drop them in the Discord channel, or you can meet us in the face-to-face and we can chat more about sharding and all about password management, which is a huge topic with everything that's going on.
Yeah, for example, a basic feature of a password manager that wasn't included here is, of course, generating the passwords. Yes. Because, yeah, you wouldn't leave a user to generate, to invent
exactly.
them.
Exactly. You can't generate your own password on blockchain.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Well, thank you again. We might have one or two questions coming in just because there's sort of a lag. We'll also have our recording available after the conference. So if they want to reach out to you on GitHub or anywhere else.
Yeah, I'll be there. Yep.
Yep. We'll have Pythonistas follow. Yeah, someone said, thank you. I'll have to watch the recording to get the code to play around. Yeah, so Andre has his GitHub. So you can definitely start forking some of those repos. All right.
I'm waiting for the issues and the pull requests.
Lots of PRs.
Right.
That's the goal, right?
Yeah.
Awesome.